Today we are in great company and first of its kind for us. We have Dr. Raju Kasambe, Associate Director, Conservation Education Center, CEC at BNHS. Dr. Raju, thank you for joining us today.
Today we will try
and know you more, because most of us have met you in person and have spent some moments with you. But probably we don't know much about the Dr. Raju as a person, your views on birds and general things. So let us get started from the beginning, Raju sir. Could you just tell us where you were born, your initial schooling, etc.?
Yeah. I was born in Yavatmal district, which is in Vidarbha, the cotton belt, now famously known as the farmer suicide area. So I was born in Yavatmal district, and I did my schooling and junior college in a place known as Dharwa, after which I moved away from my hometown, that is Dharwa. Then I moved to another place known as Karanja Lad in Washim district. Previously it was in Akola district, for my graduation. After my graduation, I could not pursue my education, so I was forced to join a job. So I joined, it took me 1 year to search a job, because I was from a background where I could not be even properly speak English. So it took me 25 interviews down to just get selected as a medical representative in a pharmaceutical company. That was in.
Thank you. We'll come to that. Raju sir, we'll come to that. Okay.
Yeah.
So tell us some funny moment about your childhood. How was it growing up in your native place, in your village?
Yeah, though it is a taluka place, it is like a village. And we had a gang of friends doing a lot of masti. And even in those days, I remember I used to catch sparrows using a gamela cutlery and a cord. And we used to put some grains for these sparrows, catch them, and then color them with pink or all those holy colors which we used to have. And try to observe where these sparrows are going. And also we used to go to the farmland, whatever agriculture we had, we still have. So we used to go there, and we used to be in nature. After the schooling, we used to have a lot of fun as kids. But of course, we had no gadgets like video games or mobile phones at that time. So it was all physical thing, yeah, running, chasing each other, like that.
Very good, very good. So did you choose biology or zoology in your studies at that time?
Yes, college time? Yeah, even for 11th, 12th, I had taken biology, and for BSc also, I chose botany and zoology, which were my favorite subject. Of course, at that time, botany, I was better than zoology. Okay. So for my graduation, I had botany, zoology, and chemistry. In Amaravati University, you have to take 3 subjects. So in the final year, so I had all the 3 subjects. Of course, I was topper in botany, and then number 2 zoology, and number 3 was chemistry. So it showed part of inclination towards biology.
Very nice, thank you. So did your parents support your study and your career choices?
We had a lot of issues, so somehow they managed to support me till my graduation. Even after getting first class, then I had to discontinue for 1 year and join a job. Okay. But they could support, they supported. It was like basic things.
All right. Okay.
We had a cycle, and we will go on a cycle only.
Great, great, great. Nice to hear that. So tell us slightly more personal. If you want, you can skip this as well. Tell us how you met Ujwala ma'am and how the marriage happened.
Oh, that was after many years. I got transferred. Like as a medical representative, I went to Nanded, then Aurangabad. From there, I went to Amravati. When I went to Amravati, I had 2 districts I had to cover to meet the doctors, Amravati and Yavatmal districts. So I used to go to Yavatmal district, and there is one place known as Vani. Same place name is there in Nashik district. So my father-in-law was a teacher there, and he was a long distant relative. So because I am going for such a far place, sometimes I will just drop to their place and have a cup of tea. So that's how I saw her, my wife. I never thought, see, I'm going to marry her. Because when I was looking for girls, I looked many. I went for chai poha for many girls' places, like might be 25, 30. And I finally came back saying that girl from Wadi. I sent my elder brother, and it finally happened. But I had seen her. I never went to see her officially at my father-in-law's house.
So okay, that, nice to hear that.
Yeah, the marriage was arranged.
great to hear that. Now that you moved from the villages you worked before, and now you moved to Goregaon, how are you coping up with Goregaon life in deep urban city?
No, I will say Goregaon life is easier because when I came to Mumbai, I stayed for a year in Thane. In from Thane, commuting from Thane to Gateway of India, I was so frightened of local trains that I traveled by AC bus from Thane, Cadbury station to museum for 1 year. And then I shifted to Dombivli. Even in Dombivli traveling, I had no option but to travel in local trains, which is so frightening. So I did that for many years. Now in Goregaon, the life is so easy because I stay very near to Film City and our center CEC is very nearby. So I don't have to travel in local trains. I'm just enjoying my life here. Last few months, 8-10 months.
We can see you are window birding as well. You are trying to study quail and crows, etc.
Yes.
Very nice.
Yes.
Yeah. So what about your kids, Vedant and Pranjali? What are they doing? Are you playing a part in their career choices as well?
My kids, luckily they are talented. So Pranjali is elder and she has got admission to dental college in Navi Mumbai, that is Nehru. And Vedant, as a kid, he was interested in birds and butterflies and insects and dragonflies, everything. So luckily he got admission in the government veterinary college, which is in Goregaon again. So Vedant and me are like very lucky. We don't have to travel. So our places of education and office are so near. So he can reach, if he gets a license to drive bike, he can reach in 10 minutes. And I reach in 20 minutes. So luckily, both are going in the right direction. And they love their colleges and field of education, which they have got luckily.
Very good. All the best to them, both of them.
Thank you.
Now we'll come back to your the job you mentioned, first job, MR, medical representative after graduation. And where all did you move? You did mention some locations. In terms of residing, where all you do you live?
I was a person from a small place. The first job I got was in Nanded. So I shifted to Nanded. But I continued my education. I mixed these both the things. Education and these things went hand in hand with my pharmaceutical job. And then I automatically turned to birds. So I went to Nanded. Before going to Nanded, when I was in my hometown, 1 year I had no job. So I took admission to BA English Literature. So when I shifted to Nanded, I got my mark sheet saying that I have passed BA in English Literature. Then as soon as I was in Nanded, I took admission to MA in English Literature and I was working in Baidyanath company. So I continued that. Then I got transferred and changed the company to Sarabhai Chemicals and shifted to Aurangabad. There I continued my education and did the MA English. Then I changed the job and joined Novartis, that previously known as Siva Gaegi, which the office was in Goregaon. That was in 96. But before shifting to Amravati from Aurangabad, I shifted to Amravati. What happened on 31st December 1995, there is one organization, Nisarga Mitra Mandal. I read a news that there is a bird watching program in Pitalkora Forest in Aurangabad district. So Mr. Dilip Yardi is the founder of this organization. So I went for that program and that time I had a binocular which I got, plastic binocular, and I was not knowing that what is a real binocular. But when I went to that event, I found a real binocular, Olympus, that time I think Pentax or something, which was as good as 1 kg. And I realized this is the binocular. So I hid my binoculars. So that others should not laugh. And that kida, that bit me. So immediately after that event, I changed to Novartis and I got Amravati as my headquarter. So I shifted to Amravati. Then when I came to Amravati, there is one organization known as Youth Hostels Association of India. So I took life membership. There every week or every month there were activities like trekking and this. So when I was going for trekking, so I realized that trekking is just walking in the forest. Why not look at what is there? There's so many birds and butterflies, and I started looking into birds. Slowly I deviated from YH members, their style of going to forest and my style of going to forest differed. So I started going to bird watching in a different way. I found some friends in that group. So we deviated and we started bird watching. So, and my education also I continued. So I did my diploma in business management, then MSc in environmental science, then MPhil, PhD and BEd. So PhD was the last, which by the time I got transferred to Nagpur. And in Nagpur, I did my PhD. So that's up to submitting. I submitted my PhD this year in Indian Grey Hornbill. That was the end of the pharmaceutical career. When I submitted the thesis, this movie came, Three Idiots. So, my journey here as a medical representative. So when I saw this movie, by the time I was also thinking in my PhD doctor who, or may I'm going to these doctors who they are also doctors, but meri izzat ke liye theek hai kya ki ek PhD banda doctor logo ke chakkar kat raha MBBS walon. That was coming to my mind again and again, and I was thinking that I am more qualified, I should do something else. And that movie really inspired me. And first day I saw it, second day I took my wife to see the movie again, and I asked her a question. I want to leave this job. And she asked, what are you going to do? And I said, we have enough money. Let me try. Give me 1 year. If I get a job, my dream job, I will join that. Otherwise, I'll come back to pharmaceuticals. But we have enough money for managing the family for 1 year without compromising the requirements or whatever luxuries we enjoyed at that time. So she said yes. And I resigned from Novartis without getting a job. So that's my pharma career.
Great, great story. Many people have asked this question. How did you move from a well-settled job to something in birding? And, you know, that was a question in many people's mind. And you have answered all of them in that section. Very good.
There is one more person who was also traveling parallel to me. That is Adesh Shukar. Adesh Shukar was a training manager in Glenmark Pharmaceuticals. And we were in touch because there was a Yahoo group, Birds of Mumbai. Birds of Bombay, which was managed by Sanjay Munga. So I used to read his post and I also used to post in that group. So I found about him and I got his number and I called him when I came to know that he is also in pharma. So one day he told me that I am resigning and I am planning to do something related to birds. So he resigned first and then I was in constant touch with him because I to take that jump. Even I was worried what this fellow is doing, whether he is successful. And he said, I have started these programs and I am earning money. I am happy. I have no more tension of the pharmaceutical. So that was also one part. So we were in constant touch. And when I came to Mumbai, I met him and we went to COD to see the flamingos when I was in Novartis. So like that. So the mind was getting ready. Yeah.
Great. He was also one of the persons who asked this question. And he's joined our session today as well. Thank you, Adesh, for joining.
Oh, great.
So let's come to BNHS. So how did you join BNHS? What happened? What position did you join?
So I was already into bird watching, and there is something which BNHS had, that is Indian Bird Conservation Network or IBA program at that time. So that was started in, I think, in 1998. And that was the days when I was in youth hostels and I was going from trekking to bird watching. So when I came to know about IBCN, I joined at that time. So I was continuously as a member of IBCN and a member of BNHS. So by the time I resigned from Novartis, I was the state coordinator of Indian Bird Conservation Network for Vidarbha part. So Dr. Emani was there and he had appointed me as the state coordinator. So when I resigned, there was an IBCN state coordinator's workshop in Bandhavgarh. So when I went there, and everybody has to introduce what he does in life, and so all the state coordinators. So I introduced that I was in Novartis and I have resigned. And I'm looking for a job. दैट वॉज माई इंट्रोडक्शन. डॉक्टर रेमानी सेड, अरे तुमने क्यों छोड़ दिया, इतना अच्छा जॉब था, अभी तो इधर IBM में वैकेंसी है, ये जो प्रोग्राम वर्कशॉप चल रहा है इसके मैनेजर की पोस्ट वैकेंट है, सो तुम अप्लाई क्यों नहीं करते. सो दैट इज वॉट पर्सनली उन्होंने ही सेड इन द इवनिंग. सो बट आई वॉज कन्फ्यूज वेदर दिस इज अ मैनेजर्स पोस्ट और दिस इज अ क्लरिकल पोस्ट. But when I finally applied and I was selected, of course there were many candidates, I was selected and immediately the result was given. Like 4 o'clock my interview was there, 5:30 Dr. Raimani called me in his cabinet and said you are selected. So I was unemployed for 4 months. After 4 months I got the job. Those were like very tense days. Of course Adesh was there to guide me.
Okay, so from that position to the current position in CAC, what was your career path and how did you end up in CAC, being associate director of CAC?
Yes, I was given charge of IBA program, important bird areas. And that was a very big task because there was Indian Bird Conservation Network also I have to manage, and their publication of MistNet magazine, a lot of responsibilities, and four to five people in my team. So every day, first thing Dr. Raimani wanted was to update the IBA book. IBA book means that time there were 466 IBAs in India. It was a huge book, 4 kg. He wanted to update. So it became 56 IBAs something. And that now became 2000 pages and 9.5 kilogram book, A4 size. So we updated that book from 2011 to up to 2016. And continuous work and workshops were going on. So the IBA program, then initially I joined as IBA project manager. Then Dr. Raimani resigned and my post was made to IBA program manager. So because it became IBA program. Unfortunately, the funding agencies, especially we got funding from BirdLife International and RSPB UK, Royal Society for the Protection of UK. Unfortunately, RSPB wanted to divert the funding to Africa. And we needed a lot of funding to run it because we also gave small grants to other NGOs. So IBA program, we had some difficult times, but Dr. Deepak Apte was there and he said, don't worry about your jobs. Either we get funding for IBA program or we can find some other responsibilities for you, but you are there. So me and my colleague Abhijit, we were given the responsibility of CEC. As in charge, when Atul Sade resigned. So we proved that we can manage CEC and particularly the online courses and all other events, we started innovative things doing. And so the Butterfly Garden, we increased the size wherever we had good sunlight. We expanded the Butterfly Garden. We got more funding. We got more admissions to courses. I took responsibilities of 3 courses, birds, butterflies, and biodiversity, 3 courses I was leading. So we started earning money. We reduced the cost to a tremendous extent. We found that there was some money not used properly. So I plugged in a lot of things and CEC became, like we started earning all salary of all our staff. And now we made CEC, I made CEC self-reliant. So we were now not dependent on other funding. Like previously we needed support from head office because the income was less, the expenses were more. Now I have 17 people in my team and we earn entire salary of all 17 people through courses and a lot of activities. Of course, this pandemic year will be difficult for us. Still, we are managing through online courses, these crash courses we started. So 2 years back, what happened? The charge was given up 3.5 years back, that is 2016. Then after 1.5 years, I was promoted as assistant director of education. So that was the best thing which came my way and also gave recognition to my work. And of course, my entire time is devoted to birds, butterflies, BNHS. That's not what I do. The 24 hours I am there. So I'm happy that I'm assistant director.
Very good. I mean, thank you for sharing that with us. So from watching three idiots, you became Professor Virus yourself, teaching everybody.
Yes, now I'm teaching.
Right. So Adesh had asked this question and he acknowledges that after a long time, there is an enthusiastic team in at BNHS, especially in birding area, because of your leadership and your initiatives. So what message do you have for the youngsters?
Yeah, I'll say you do what you love, not your parents want. Like, your parents want you to be doctors, engineers. But if you love birds, or if you love some, might be you might love English literature. So you go for English literature, don't become an engineer. If you love painting, go for something which is related to arts. Don't become an engineer or a doctor. And your parents should not pressurize the kids to become something which they want. Pet mein bachcha hai to bole mera bachcha engineer banne wala hai. So that should not be the attitude. And the young generation, as soon as they realize they are young adults, like 18 years, at least they should take decisions of their life, at least in deciding what they want to do. Because I have seen lots of people visiting CEC and totally frustrated, saying that I wanted to become this and that, but my father wanted to become me to become a doctor. Even one boy, he was sent to US to become an engineer, and he did not complete his course, even after spending 1 crore rupees by his daddy. And when they came to CEC, the son on his face said, "Daddy, you wanted me to become an engineer. I never wanted." So they started fighting in my cabin. So a lot of things, these things are happening. So it's better to follow your passion. That is what I think Adesh is also an idol for us, like that.
Thank you for that advice. I'm sure youngsters will see that, understand what you have said. There was a question from Vinit. You were a birder before, you mentioned. So how did you become an ornithologist?
So I had that thinking that whatever I see, I should write. So I was writing articles in Marathi. Then one day what happened, I discovered a breeding colony of blue-tailed beaters in Amravati district. And I found that a person who is more active on internet, he took advantage of the situation and he published my finding in Sanctuary magazine. So I was so much frustrated, and I realized that in technology, we are falling back. Somebody is using our findings. Mm-hmm. But I don't mind if somebody uses it and puts my name also, gives due credit to me. And one more famous photographer, he also came to me and objected that, he said, "How can you identify blue-tailed beaters? Kya difference hota hai?" And he tortured me. But I said, "It is blue-tailed beater. Don't worry. Don't worry about me. It is blue-tailed beater. I know." But then his purpose was to know the location of the breeding colony. And next day morning, he went there and took nice pictures and published those pictures in Sanctuary magazine. So his purpose was not to object my things. His purpose was to get the location from me so that he can get nice pictures. So these guys went there, took pictures and published in Sanctuary magazine. So that was very frustrating. Had they mentioned my name, I would not have any problem. Then I decided that, okay. Then I immediately bought a computer and took internet connection. That time the dial-up connection, trin-trin-trin-trin, it was like 30K, 300KB file also, it would take 15 minutes to download. So I took internet connection and decided that I should write. Then we started writing. Of course, the first note was, we found the blue-tailed beaters colony was one of them. And I took that subject for my MSc dissertation. And not only that, we found a colony, breeding colony of Pratim Coles and River Terns and Little Terns in Amravati district. So that also became a short note for a newsletter of Bird Watchers, which is a birding journal. So there I started. So bird watching and publishing research papers, automatically you become an ornithologist. If you just keep seeing birds, you are a birder or a bird watcher. But when you start writing papers, you become an ornithologist. So that's the journey. So before I joined BNHS, I was already an ornithologist.
Great. And you did talk about, we'll come to you.
Yeah. When I joined, I had already published, I think, 38 research papers and short notes in various journals. So that was the best thing in my biodata.
I'm sure we all will learn from that experience of yours as well. So talking about writing, you mentioned your PhD thesis in brief earlier. So why did you study the Indian grey hornbill for your PhD? Did you do a research before you writing the thesis, or how was that journey?
I was in Nagpur at that time, and I was looking for a subject on which I can do PhD. And the best subject was hornbill, because the hornbills are found in Nagpur city in good number. And I was staying in Nagpur. So it was very easy for me just to visit all the nesting sites and take observations, collect excreta, do video shootings, whatever. The methodology was, of course, there was nothing like catching any birds. The methodology was only taking observations, analysis of excreta, analysis of fruits, observing trees. That was the methodology. So I selected hornbill only because it was possible for me to do both. That is the medical representative job. I continue and do the PhD also. So I will get up at 5 o'clock, and 6 o'clock I will be at the nest, hornbill nest. And up to from 6 o'clock to 9 o'clock, I will complete observations as well as visit to all the 5-6 nests in Nagpur city. And by 9 o'clock, I will come back to home, take a bath, fill my bag of medical representatives, have breakfast, and go for the field work. That is to visit the various hospitals. At 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock, I'll come back, have lunch. And again, 4 o'clock or 5 o'clock, I am back at the hornbill nest till the hornbill sleep. That is up to 7 o'clock. Again, I come back to my house, change the bag. That is the keep the camera bag, take the medical representative bag, go out till 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock. Again, come back and then have a dinner and sleep. That was my day, like 5 o'clock in the morning up to 9, 10, 11 o'clock. So I did this 2 years. I did it very strictly. Out of those 2 years, hornbills breed from March to June. So this March to June was very, very hectic for me. Like every day morning 5, I will get up, whatever what happens. And I'll observe up to 9 o'clock. So that went on for March, April, May, June, 4 months in the year. So 4 months and 4 months, that 2 years. Third year, what happened? Third year, I could not complete the entire cycle, but I took observation because I joined BNHS in April. So when the nesting was still going on, I had to join. So 3 years I took observations.
That is definitely a great dedication and passion you had at that time. Just one announcement. Sharda, if you could please put your video off and your shopping, we can see you. Thank you. Thanks for telling us about your PhD, and you mentioned that you have written lots of papers and books. So tell us about the books you have written, and there was a specific question. You have given so many ebooks for free. So how come you are able to do that, and why do you do that? And lastly, which book is in the pipeline?
So when I was still in Novartis, I wrote one small book known as Bharatatil Sankatgrasta Pakshi, Threatened Birds in India. That was just for 50-60 pages book. So that was published by one Nagpur Rocha Publications, costing 50 rupees. Then when I came to BNHS, I was already working on a book, Butterflies of Maharashtra, Maharashtratil Fulpakare. So after joining BNHS, it was already submitted to a publisher, but it was published after I joined BNHS. Now it is in the second edition. That is these books are there. The Threatened Birds book is already out. Means I don't know what happened to the publisher. The Maharashtratil Fulpakare is the best book I have written, successful book, as a marketing point of view also. When I came to Mumbai, I wrote other books. I published my thesis, PhD thesis, as a book. We worked on the IBA book of BNHS, which came out in 2016, very huge book, 2000 pages. We also worked on IBAs of Maharashtra as a small book, a baby book of that IBA book. But it came first, and the bigger book came later. Then we also worked on Threatened Birds of Maharashtra, again Maharashtra specific book. These books were published by BNHS and Oxford University Press. So those are with BNHS and for sale on Amazon and all websites and add-ons and BNHS. Besides this, I started publishing e-books, and the first e-book, Maharashtratil Shambhar Samanya Pakshi, 100 Common Birds in Maharashtra. That's a Marathi book, and that's an e-book, and it's a free e-book. So when I realized that thousands of people downloaded, by today there are 25,000 downloads for this e-book. So that was very interesting thing. And I realized that if I publish a hard copy, it is very difficult to sell even 1,000 copies. And the publishers don't really give you anything, damn thing. Nothing comes to you. But that's not an that's not a worry, because if the book is costing 100 rupees, you get 10 rupees per book. Okay, and they never give it to you. So money is not an issue. My concern was, how can I take the knowledge about birds and butterflies to the public in the medium which they are using? In the medium means, now we are using laptops, we are using computers, we are using mobile phones. So everybody is on mobile. Everybody is using a tab, a big Android phone. Okay, nobody is reading a book. If you go to a local train, out of 100 people in the bogie, you will find a guy reading a novel. All others are there on their mobile phones. So if I want to spread the knowledge about birds and butterflies, I need to give the knowledge in the medium where my audience is. All bird watchers are on mobile, laptop, phone, or laptops. So if I give a book which is there available on that medium, they will read. It will get more downloads, more spread more. That was my idea. So I first wrote this 100 common birds in Maharashtra. Then I decided even butterflies is required. So a big book I wrote, actually, Butterflies of Western Ghats. I could have easily sold the book for 50 rupees or 100 rupees as a e-book also. But I decided to make it like free. And I gave it free. So again, this book also became very successful. And by now, I think there are 29,000 downloads for this book. So this inspired me. And one more thing is, people call me, people send me messages on WhatsApp, Facebook, mobile phone, email, saying that I have downloaded your book. It's very nice. It's very useful. And the messages come not only from the remotest place in Maharashtra for the Marathi book, Gadchiroli district, but also from US for the butterfly book. The downloads are from Singapore, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, United States. This inspires. And then I wrote Shetatil Pakshi, that is birds in agriculture in Marathi. Again, it got 14,000 downloads. And then finally, I decided that I should write it in English. So I made the same book in, but with more improvements and more species, because it's now in India. So I wrote the birds in agriculture in India with, I think, 114 or some species, which are seen in agriculture. And my idea of writing the book is not to tell how bad birds are for agriculture. My idea is to say how birds are good to agriculture. And I have tried to correlate the birds, like the owl to Goddess Lakshmi, and how they are important in culture. And if there are owls in the agriculture, how Lakshmi will come? Lakshmi means cash, wealth. How prosperity will come to your house? That's the purpose of writing the book, and not telling how parakeets cause damage to your agriculture. That's not the purpose. So that's why I turned to e-books, and now I have been able to reach to many books. And not only these e-books give me recognition. They give me recognition, and I got love and affection from the birding community, butterfly community, all over the world. Otherwise, at least all over India, I will say, butterflies. After the Western Ghats book, I got so much recognition. People started considering me as an expert on butterflies, frankly speaking. That e-book has given me that identity, that I am something in butterflies. Otherwise, with that Marathi book also, I don't think I had that recognition. So this gave me everything. Money is not an issue because I am getting salary. So that's not an issue for me. So that's the idea.
Great. Sir, money is not an issue, but how do you get so much energy to write on several facets of birds and publish them? How do you get that energy?
People appreciate that. That gives you, that keeps you fueled to work more and more. And I love it, basically. So because I don't do anything, I don't read any novels, or I don't read anything else except birds and butterflies. So all the 24 hours, whatever time I am awake, I'm with birds and butterflies. I'm writing something or doing something related to that only. Nothing else except my family. So that's all.
That's really fascinating. And I have noticed, and Uday Agasha is also asking this, that these days you are writing your life events on Facebook, especially in Marathi with Vidarbha flavor in it. Are you planning to consolidate everything into an autobiography or something like that? If not, we recommend you should.
Okay. Of course, but once I think it is comprehensive and it's giving a good outline, I will make it into a e-book so everybody can read.
But we do definitely like your local flavor there in that.
Yes, I am trying to mix that. And people are appreciating. That is our one more good thing. Thanks for appreciating. Yeah. I'm sure I'll continue writing that. Even I'm writing stories about birds and butterflies of my experiences. Like I wrote on an experience in Israel. How the crow problem is there and how they are trying to eradicate the crows. What are the problems of bee eaters? How they are trying to control the bee eaters. Wow. Even bird stories and life stories, both I am trying to write continuously. So whenever I get time, I'm writing. Even poems.
Yeah, we have seen that as well. And Israel, I especially like that because I have also been to Elath and I have seen that place. So I kind of, linked it with my personal experience there. Let's come to some of the conservation related queries. Many people have asked this and I'll go one by one. What do you think about the state of affairs of decline of wildlife in India and the loggerheads with the development versus government apathy towards
wildlife
in general? Yeah, general wildlife.
Let us skip this. Let's come to birds and butterflies.
All right. Okay. So, so you mentioned skip wildlife, so I will skip. But any reaction on by BNHS, not by you, on various environmental disasters which are happening in recent time, like mining in Dengpatkai, the Maguri Bill, proposed railway in Western Ghats near Karwar, land acquisition in Vedat Jungle.
Yeah, a lot of problems.
BNHS doing?
There are a lot of problems. I leave all these problems to our director. I don't interfere into that. Let him comment. And BNHS is a strong organization. I'm sure they will take good decisions and it's in the right hands. So Dr. Apte knows how to manage these things. So let us leave it to him.
Okay, let's we appreciate that. Sure. What about RA? You want to, you live now close to RA?
Leave it. No, leave it to the director.
Okay, so director. Let's come to birds. Come to birds then. GIB. GIB is at the brink of the extinction, in spite of being a priority species for conservation for so many years since 1990s. Still, are we getting the results we want on GIB?
Now they already started artificial breeding. Also nowadays it is called as conservation breeding. So conservation breeding was the last thing, but conservation breeding will also not help if the habitat is not there. All the entire habitat in Maharashtra is getting converted to sugarcane plantation because now there is water, everybody wants development. And there were a lot of issues. If you look into Maharashtra, there were a lot of issues. In the sense, the sanctuary was something like 8,000 square kilometers. I have not exact figures. 8,000 kilometers square kilometers included the Solapur city. That means anybody wants to sell his house in Solapur city, need a permission because it comes in the sanctuary. So this was a very wrong decision to declare a city as a part of the sanctuary. So people thought that Bustard is against their development. Nothing can be done. They can't sell their agriculture or the kheti badi to somebody else because it comes in sanctuary. How can the private lands, which were private for so many generations, be included in the sanctuary? It should not have happened actually. So people went against it, and every time they had problem, they will go to the politicians and they will say, "Sir, hamara problem solve kariye. Ye mado is a problem." So what the politicians said, "You solve your problem. Solve your problem. If you solve the mado problem, so they just kill the mado simply." So they are trying to solve the problems. Now their idea is that if there is no GIB, there will be no GIB sanctuary. And no GIB sanctuary means all the notifications, everything will be taken away and they can encroach on land. So people have encroached on grasslands and converted them into agriculture. But nobody wanted to take any action. And the people will go against bustards. If the people go against bustards, the bustards can't survive because it is not a species like a forest species. If there is a forest, it will stay inside the forest. It is a landscape species. It will stay in the grassland. It will go to soybean cultivation for feeding. It will go to various types of cultivation for feeding. So it can be easily killed, and it is a species like docile. It tolerates human presence, so it can be killed very easily. So I will say the policies, there were a lot of problems, including policies which went against the people. And this is known as antipathy. So the Bastard, what Bastard faced was antipathy of the people, leading to killing of Bastards. And same thing is there in Rajasthan now. And now we have Sujit. Sujit worked in Nannaj and Maharashtra. So Sujit very well understands the problems, and he is working, I am sure he is working in the right direction. So the first thing is to, people loved Bastard, okay. They said, we don't have anything against Bastard, but solve our problems. And it is very difficult for the Forest Department to take decisions, like instant decision nobody can take. You can take a decision of plantation, but you cannot take a decision of denotifying this area and making a map, saying that this is your agriculture. This is a, you cannot just go and say, this is an encroachment, remove it. If you remove it, all the entire village will go against the Forest Department. So it's very difficult. So that should have been done long back, but the Forest Department was not quick in taking actions, except managing the grassland. So a lot of things happened, and it took many years. And last, I think after 2005, the population crashed, and now it's, you know the situation. I hope this will not happen in Rajasthan. This happened in Karnataka, this happened in Madhya Pradesh. Same thing is happening in Madhya Pradesh for the lesser florists. Same thing is happening. Because agriculture people want agriculture for cattle grazing, people want, grasslands for cattle grazing, grasslands for mining, grasslands for encroachment so that they can cultivate. So everybody wants the grassland for their own purpose. And there has to be quick actions, strong forest departments, strong policies, and a lot of things which is not happening. I hope at least in Rajasthan it will happen, in Gujarat it will happen, so that we have these two species, not only Bastard, even lesser Florican, same way, same grassland, same problems. Both two species will be saved. Let's hope. Let's pray, actually.
Let's hope that, yeah. Let's hope that, you know, they are conserved so that our children can see them in the wild as well. Thank you for that. I'll move on to now specific bird birding questions sent in by our participants. I'll go one by one. Anjan is asking, specifically for bird identification, should people visit the field with a pair of binoculars plus notebook plus reference book and try to draw a picture of the bird, then try to identify, or is it better to take a camera, click a picture, identify there, and then later identify? What is better and practical?
Yeah, if you don't take binoculars with you don't remain bird watchers. You become bird photographers. Okay, so bird watching is watching with your eyes and with the binoculars. So if you are not watching, you are a bird photographer. So if you want to be a bird watcher, so I suggest, these are two extreme things. I don't suggest extreme. I suggest the middle one. Middle one, you have the camera and you have the binoculars. So take the pictures, and then now you got 4 or 5 pictures you can identify. Look at the bird, man. The bird, it may just fly away. Look at the bird, then only you will say, I have seen the bird. So take pictures. Pictures, I am not against. Yeah, pictures are very important for a lot of things. So take pictures, but look at it through the binoculars or with your eyes. If it is a Bustard, look with your eyes, there is displaying. Bestoliscus butchat makes beautiful display. So you have to look at the behavior. You have to enjoy that. Then only you will remember. No? Otherwise, this life will just pass on. Everything you have seen through the binoculars, through the camera hole. I don't think that's good birding. But photography is now, it is essential. It is an essential part of birding. If you see something rare and you don't have a photograph, many bird watchers won't believe you. Of course, if I have seen a rare bird and I don't have a photograph and somebody says he doesn't believe me, I don't give a damn. I have seen a bird, I'm happy. Okay. But if I have a camera, I always love to take a picture. Do take pictures.
Thank you for that, Edward.
Do take pictures first and then look at it.
Great advice. I'm sure all bird watchers will adhere to that. Question from Radhika, specifically about Asian palm swift. Is it common for them to fly in flocks together?
Yes, it is common. They fly in flocks. Okay. And wherever palm trees are there, you can see their flocks.
Okay. Prasad and Parag have asked questions about the death of the birds. Do birds die natural death? I mean, how do they die? Normally we see animal carcass or insects lying around. We don't see birds like that except for roadkills and electric shock and everything there. What is that mechanism? How does it work? Phenomena.
Any animal which takes birth on this planet has to die. So all birds die in natural death. Unfortunately, what we see in cities is the unnatural death, like through electric shock and entangling in kite manja. These are unnatural deaths. But birds die at natural death just like all other animals. So you may not see it because in nature, the dead bird doesn't remain for many days because bird has got very little flesh. So it immediately eaten by somebody. Say like if a big bird die in a forest, there are hyenas which will just go and finish the carcass. Nothing will remain. The feathers disintegrate in just few days. So you can't see it. Just like consider a bison is dead in forest. The skeleton will remain there for years together. But a bird skeleton you can't see. Because the big animal will eat the bones also. They are hollow. So nothing will remain. That's why we don't see many carcasses. But go to any zoo. Ask any person who has had parakeets or bajrigars as pets. So the birds die. They become old and die. I have a friend in Nagpur. He had a rose ring parakeet. The rose ring parakeet survived for 22 years. He remembers that because when he purchased the parakeet, his daughter was 1 year old. So when she became 23rd, the parakeet died. And it was old. I also visited. I saw the parakeet. It was old and behaving like old bird. So it died its natural death. So every animal which takes birth on this planet has to die a death, whether it is natural or unnatural. You can't just. But if we spend more hours in forest, you will find dead birds. Unfortunately, we don't spend much. Once in a week, we spend 6 hours and we expect everything to be seen. That cannot happen. But those who spend more time get to see more dead birds. So I have seen many dead birds in forest also. So they are everywhere. But there is natural predation. There is natural predation in forest because the ecosystem is alive. So birds don't have to die naturally. As soon as they are unfit, they become sick or old, somebody comes and eats them. So you don't find a bird dying and falling down like humans. Right.
Survival of the fittest, as you
say. Yes. Right. There is food chain waiting. The other predators are waiting for food. So as soon as it's not able to fly properly, others take charge and just make it food, good food. Yes.
Right. Okay, further on, more bird question. Mahalakshmi asked, how do birds keep themselves clean even during non-rainy season, except peacock, you see magpie robins. They look so clean even with so much pollution. Their color doesn't, get, pale or, it doesn't change at all. How does that happen?
This is known as maintenance behavior. And birds are very, very careful about their health, and especially the health of their feathers, their beak and their talons. They are predatory birds. If you look at sunbirds, they are very careful about their beak, and hornbills, very careful about beaks. And every bird is careful about their feathers and wings because they are very important for flying. As soon as there is some problem, they can't fly, predators will just kill them. So what they do is they have maintenance behavior. Maintenance behavior is taking water bath. If there is no water in the forest, the birds like sunbirds and tailor birds, they take bath on dew, which is there on the leaf, large leaves in the forest. They take dew bath, but they take bath every day. Then they bask in sunlight, spread all the feathers, take very good sunlight. And their birds, especially those birds which nest in holes and tunnels and has to play in mud for any reason, they take more care of themselves. Like the beaters, the hornbills, the roller, Indian roller, these are the birds which nest in holes. Like beaters has to dig through the soil. The kingfishers, oriental dwarf kingfisher, white-throated kingfisher, they have to dig or excavate tunnels in the soil, in the river cutting or in a wall. So they get, if the body gets soiled or muddy, so they take bath. Many times woodcap will come to our water hole and take bath when the nest is being excavated. So they understand that our body is becoming soil or with mud. So they will take bath multiple times. Once they come, they will take 15 dips. So taking water bath And when the nesting actual happens, when the chicks are inside, they also take mud bath. Like the sparrows also take mud bath. Mud bath is a process by which they try to clean their bodies from disease causing ectoparasites, which are on the outside. So you can see anytime you go in forest or go for birding, you can see a lot of birds preening their feathers. So as soon as the tummy is full, they spend most of their time in body maintenance, cleaning the beak, cleaning the feathers. Every feather, they will move their beak like this. Every feather. So to clean everything. Every feather. So that's the way they clean and keep themselves fit and fine for flying every day. They spend a lot of time. So dust bath.
Talking about maintenance.
Dust bath, water bath, preening. There are oil glands. Many birds have got oil glands. So they spread oil on the body. This oil is also insecticidal. And that gland is known as uropygial gland. So spreading the oil. So these are all methods by which they keep themselves fit. That's why you can see the birds shining every day.
Great. And you talked about maintenance. And there's one question by Sharda. Why are most female birds dull unlike their males?
In nature, female has got... nature favors the males. So there is injustice in human language done to females, and females have more responsibility. How the nature has favored the males? This actually, the answer is slightly long. Males, nature has favored males because male has got something which they can produce in huge quantity, spending very little energy, that is sperm. But female has to spend lots of energy in producing something which is scarce, that is eggs. The female birds has to spend so much energy to produce one egg. Entire 24 hours diet or 1 to 2 days food is consumed in producing one egg. And one female can produce hardly few eggs in a year, in one breeding season. And many birds breed only once in a year. Like vultures, they will lay only 1 or 2 eggs in a year. So it's very costly for the female to invest so much energy, and she can't do it again and again. So if the female die, so the chance of producing our nestlings or chicks is zero. If there is a flock and 50% of females die, just imagine the population will crash down. But if 50% of the males are killed, nothing will happen. One male will mate with 50 females because the male doesn't have to spend much energy in producing sperm, and the male produces millions and millions of sperms. Now, the female, you realize that the female is very important and should not get killed. Even on a probability basis, we need more survival rate for females. Now, the nature must favor females somewhere. So, the female has become dull colored. Because she has to stay at one place on the eggs and she cannot move. She has to incubate the eggs and she should not be colorful. If she is colorful, predators will attack. And the nesting will fail. Whereas male, if the males has to be colorful because they need to display and attract. Now there is competition because the females are very selective. Now they know that they are investing so much energy. They have to invest so much energy. So they don't want to give the eggs a chance to fertilize with the male who is not good, who is unfit, who is not so smart, beautiful. So the female will be choosy because she has to give all her energy and physical fitness to one person. So she becomes very choosy and selects the best male. Now, because there is competition, the males try to impress in different ways. So in those different ways, one can be singing, another can be displaying, dancing, and another can be having bright and beautiful colors. So these evolved in the males because they wanted to impress the female, which is scarce. Her resources are scarce. The number of eggs he is going to produce is scarce. So the males become more colorful, females become duller and more camouflaged and obliterative in coloration in nature. That is the science behind this.
Great. Thank you. We didn't know about that. Just one announcement for all the participants. If you can enable your video for just 2 or 3 minutes, we'll take a group picture while we are at it. I will ask the question to Mr. Dr. Raju. While he's answering, you can enable and then we'll take a picture as whenever everybody is available. And definitely do a thumbs up as well. So in the meanwhile, while everybody enables the video, I will ask the next question, and Raju sir, you can answer that question while everybody is enabling. A question from Sharda is, can birds communicate with other species or other families of birds?
Come near to the cameras. Come near to the cameras so that we can take a picture.
Great.
Trying to start another software. Just wait. Okay.
Everybody, please take your own pictures as well from your mobile, because I have some glare behind my computer. So if you can also take.
Okay, great.
Thank you, everyone.
This is a very nice idea.
Thank you.
All right. So shall we move on? We are at 12 o'clock now, 1 hour. Participant, question to you. Are you okay with continuing for another 20 minutes? You can type it on chat. Yes, is some of them are saying yes. Raju sir, we'll continue. So yeah, communication. No, so you talked the question about communication with other species. Do they do it? Birds?
Yes. Actually they don't want to communicate. It may not be intentional, but it happens. That means they understand each other's language. So when the birds are giving alarm calls, the monkeys understand that the birds are giving alarm calls. So they will also become alert. For example, when a leopard is there, and might be the first bird who sees the leopard is the lapwing, red-vetted lapwing, and starts giving alarm calls. So if there are spotted deers in the forest, or if there are black bucks in the grassland, the black bucks understand that there is a threat, and they also become alert. So there is a communication. So the lapwing is not doing it intentionally to inform the black buck, but the lapwing is doing it to inform its own babies and to inform other lapwings. But others understand this. So there is a communication.
Great. Okay. Good to know that. A couple of questions on physical features of birds. There seem to be some physical features of birds. Through the evolution, which are like non-practical, like for example, long plumage of peacocks, for example. They seem to be a handicap for the bird, for its survival, to escape from its predators. So how this has not evolved?
So I was just talking about this in the one question before, the dull colors in female and bright colors in males. So this is one thing, this is a exaggerated thing which has developed in peacocks or Indian peafowl males, but scientists have done a lot of research on this, whether this hinders or results into more predation in peacocks, and they have found some very interesting things. Though for us it looks like the peacock has got problems, but it puts only 0.1% extra pressure on them when they are flying. That has been proved. So it's not true that they have problem. What is the problem is that they have to spend nearly 3.5% of their energy to produce those long feathers. That is the big problem, and not the problem of flying. That has been proved. That's very interesting thing. That's what I was saying. We can have another presentation on only peacock display and courtship display in peacocks. If time permits, we can organize.
We'll do that. One question on migrations. This is the only question on migration. How do they know that they have to follow a particular route, go to a place, and then follow another route, or maybe the same route back to the original location? What is their navigation capability?
There are a lot of theories actually. One of them is, of course, magnetic field theory is also there, but that has been proved to be being used by butterflies, and might be the birds are using, but the birds have something known as the genetic knowledge. Through generations they have understood, they have learned that they have to migrate in this direction, like the pied cuckoo and the common cuckoo going to Africa, or the Amur falcons going to Africa. directly jumping into the sea at Mumbai coast or western coast of India and reaching the eastern coast of Africa. So the chicks which hatch in this year are not guided by any parents. They just start their journey and reach there. So this is the something, it's like genetic learning. It's there in their genes. So this one, there are other things like experience. When the bird, big birds like the cranes and geese migrate, you see, it is believed that the older birds take the lead. So they when they are flying, they fly in V formation, and the bird here, the bird who is leading is considered to be the adult and the senior most bird who knows the route, the landmarks on the ground. There are other things also there, because there are many birds which migrate in the night time. So it is believed that they also look at the galaxies, the overall view of the sky. This is believed because when it's total dark night or no moon night, the birds get misguided and many flocks dive into cities. So this is also one more evidence. So there are a lot of theories, and it may not be just one thing which decides the migration or how the birds migrate. There might be, it might be a combination of different things used by the bird to navigate, to understand and to remember the routes of migration.
Great, great. We have lots of questions. So I'm giving preference to the questions which have come beforehand. And then I will soon open the forum as well for asking questions online. Anjana has asked, why do birds have primary, secondary and other type of feathers? What is the practical use of those feathers, different types of feathers?
It's like our hand. It's like our hand. If you cut the thumb, you lose the capacity of holding things. So birds, this hand got converted to this one part and two parts. So all the feathers attached here are primaries. All the feathers attached here are secondaries. So that it can fold and use like just like human hand. So it has evolved through millions of years, like 1.5 crore years. It took for the birds to evolve the feathers. And primaries or secondaries, they have very different functions. So you need to look and understand the flight, mechanism for flight of birds. So primaries and secondaries, primaries are turned outside, secondaries are turned inside. So they are for flapping and putting the, pressing the air down, and so that bird gets the lift. And tail is only for managing the direction, like a rudder, and also to stop the speed, like a brake when they are landing. So that those have got different functions. And if you disable something, like if you remove the primaries, the bird cannot fly properly, and they just land down somewhere. So it has evolved and it has got its own functions. So
and very good comparison.
There are other types of feathers like downy feathers, plumes, which cover the body and help the bird in maintaining temperature. If even the snowy owl is there, which stays in Arctic where the snow is there, the birds can easily survive because they have feathers which is better than any of your jerkin or sweater. They have got so much protection. The feathers are so much insulation. So it's an evolution in a different direction, but they are very fit to survive in different environments.
Very good explanation. Thank you. Rajesh asked question, are there any birds like chameleon which change color based on who's around them? Do we know?
I don't think, but the birds have their own tricks, like the ponderon. Ponderon, if you look, when the ponderon is perched, it's totally dull colored, and if it is in the garbage or in a stream, you can't see the ponderon. But when it flies, it has got those white colors come out. Okay, so when it fly, it's different. When it's perched, it's different. But at the same time, one more thing happens. For the prey, which is there in the water, when they are looking up, it looks like it is white, so it looks like just sky. And the legs are green, so it looks like weeds. So many things in one bird. So it is changing colors, no? When the bird is like pheasants, when they are walking, you may not see the colors. When they fly, or ducks, all these water birds, the shovelers, pintails, all migratory ducks, when they are sitting in the water, you can't see something which is very, very colorful in them. But when they fly, there is something known as speculum on their wings. It's like a spot, square-shaped spot, which shines. which shines with the light. When they are flapping wings, that patch shines. And every species has got different colored patch. Now, so it's like they know when to show which color. So when they are migrating, just consider they are migrating 20,000 above feet or 20,000 feet above the land, and might be there is a cloud. So these colors are iridescent colors. When they are in the clouds, the other ducks can see these iridescent wing patches or speculum, and they know that all my colleagues are nearby and I am with the flock. So they orient themselves just looking at those speculum. They can't see the entire bird. They can just see those shining patches flying around, and they just manage the flock properly through the clouds when they're dense clouds also. So just imagine how they are using this color. So this color depends on light, angle of light also. But you won't see this color many times until they flap their wings. So they don't change colors. And there are birds like hummingbirds and sunbirds, when they are doing courtship display, they move their feathers in such a way that you can see different colors. Again, these are iridescent colors. These are colors made from the arrangement of the pigments, arrangement of the feathers, structure of the feathers. These are structural coloration. One color, the bird is sitting there, for example, ponderal, the dirty color you can see. It's the natural color which is born by the pigments. So that color will never change. Whichever direction you put, that will remain same. The iridescent colors, it depends on the angle of light. You can see different colors. Hummingbirds, there are beautiful videos available. And pheasants, you can see different colors. Peacock, you can see that color, iridescent color, according to the angle of light or on their breast also. So though they don't change, you feel that they are changing the colors.
Understood. Nicely explained, sir. Thank you. Bala is asking, do they also have sense of beauty? Do they admire what they see from other colors, other birds, other flowers?
Yes.
Or what is the understanding?
Of course, I will say females have better understanding than the males, because females need to choose the best, the most beautiful, the most iridescent, the best dancing guy, the best singing guy. I will say for all these good things like singing, dancing, colors, females must be having a better eye, a better ear, so all these good things or beauty things or quotient, beauty quotient. So they do have, 100% they have.
you talked about singing. So we've seen some birds like racketed drongo, OMR, they imitate other birds. Why do they do that?
There are a lot of reasons. One of the reasons is to avoid competition. For example, racket-tailed drongo is an insect-eating bird. So it don't want other insect-eating birds to come around. It also don't want the predators to come around, like the shikra. So by mimicking, it declares that there are all these species are already present here. Like if it imitates the call of a shikra, there is a shikra 1 kilometer away. Now that shikra knows that there is one shikra here who is having its territory. So that shikra will never come here. So shikra is excluded. So it makes call up black drongo. Now black drongo realize there is already one black drongo here having a territory. So black drongo competition gone. So it mimics the call of magpie robin. The magpie robin also runs away. So a lot of species are removed and he enjoys the food. So that is one reason. So there are other stories also, other theories also. To avoid predation, like these birds, shrike also, long-tailed shrike also is known to mimic a lot of calls. So if the long-tailed shrike mimics calls of shikra, so it is saving its babies which are there in the nest, because shikra can come and kill its babies. So the predation, ensuring foraging territory, that's what, these are the reasons. But they are 100%, there is no theory which can explain to 100% that this is the perfect answer. Yeah.
Great. Let's come to some urban birding. Talking about sparrows, I have two contrasting questions. One person, Sheila, is asking, what can we do to help bring the sparrow population up? Another question is from Adesh. He's saying, house sparrows were never threatened species. It declined in some pocket, but it, like any other thing, they declined in some pocket, they are increasing somewhere else. But there was a lot of propaganda on, you know, creating nests and selling nests, sparrow day, etc. So when there was no, was there any scientific data for BNHS to support this sparrow days and things like that?
No, BNHS did not.
So what is the sparrow days on that?
Sparrow days, somebody started, Mohammad Dilawar started sparrow days and all this campaign, not BNHS. But they, at the international level, there is a campaign from BirdLife International. That campaign was known as, is known as Keep the Common Birds Common. That's the campaign. Because in UK, they have a lot of data about birds, like 100 years data, they have entire data, and you know how the populations of birds, common birds are also declining. A lot of common birds, I will say, like, not only sparrow, but other birds also might be there in their country, whatever is, like the robins and might be those. Those are declining in Europe and other countries. So this data speaks about their countries. We, India, never had very good data about sparrow decline or whatever. Because we have, there were no common bird monitoring programs in India, which are required and which we have started. Of course, the sparrow population, even I was very skeptical about whether it is declined or it increased. So now a lot of research papers are coming up with 1 year, 2 year, 3 years data, and there are contrasting stories. So this must be the sparrows are declining in some pockets and stable in some pockets, might be increased in some pockets. So there, it's possible. All the things are possible. The question is about feeding. You are asking one more question. I don't.
So the question, one question was, what can we do to increase the sparrow population?
I think we don't. We should not aim at increasing. We should help in supporting the birds. So feeding is not the right solution, because it may increase the population, like it overpopulation. Like we have done to crows and pigeons and parakeets in Mumbai city. And it's very dangerous to have more crows, because crows kill all other birds and their nests and chicks and eggs. So they are very destructive. So by supporting one species, you might kill, you might create havoc, which we have created in big city, all big cities, like the increasing population of pigeons and crows. So we don't want that population of sparrows to come, because if we increase the population of sparrows to a very good big extent, what will happen is that will support more crows, because the crows are finally going to feed on the chicks of the sparrows. But we should have a stable population or a good and healthy population. What we can do is we can keep, I don't support feeding, but I always support having nest boxes for sparrows with the less hole size. Because we have cut the trees, we have constructed buildings which don't support them. There is no place for, no place means there are little lesser chances for sparrows to make nests. So we can have nests. If the sparrows come, well and good. If they don't come, it's okay. So it's not like that for every nest there should be sparrows. If we just provide opportunities, if the sparrows need, they will take advantage. But we should not feed. I am not very keen on feeding birds. Let them find their own food. Because we have concretized most of the city parts. I think the data says that 70% of Mumbai's ground is already concretized. So there will be very less chance of having earthworms or insects being available to the sparrows. So sparrows will not increase to more than a particular level, because when they are having chicks, they need insects and not grains. So if the insects are not there, sparrows will never be there. So you need trees, you need some open space or wilderness. Small plot of wilderness, a lot of sparrows will come. But if there is no small plot of wilderness or an empty plot where grass is growing, the sparrows, even if they are there, their breeding rate will be very less. So just feeding them grains is not going to help, and that's not recommended. I don't support it too much.
Okay, you have answered 2-3 more questions which were there about pigeons and bird feeding and how we should feed, etc. So you have answered both, all of those together. There are few more questions in terms of supporting, okay, ornithology. So question from Anjan is, what should society do to support ornithology or ornithologists?
Nothing but have more greenery around you. That's all. The birds will take care of themselves.
Yeah. Okay.
Don't feed
all
them.
Right. All
because
all
see, right. What we are feeding feeding pigeons is like selective feeding. If there is selective food available for sparrows, so if you want to feed sparrows, there is different food available. But that's not good. But having just having greenery, keeping one small empty plot. If your society has got a small plot for a garden, I will suggest you grow some native trees and let the grass grow. When the native grass grows, it will have lots of insects. It will attract lots of birds. That will take care of the things. It will become a small ecosystem.
Okay, so I will open for the forum to ask questions. Before that, one last question from Jairaj. He's specifically asking, which was that bird which you and Adesh sir followed on a bike, like Jay and Viru? What was that? Tell us about that story in short.
I don't know. We went to see flamingos in CUD actually. Yeah, we went to when okay. I came to Mumbai first time. He came to Dadar to receive me with two helmets, and he took me to CUD, and that was my first visit to CUD and seeing so many flamingos in my life. I think that is the first one.
Okay, good. Vidya Sagar, you had a long question on flamingo migration, tourism in Mumbai, etc. Why don't you unmute and ask that question yourself?
Hello,
hello.
Sir. This is Vidya Sagar Hariharan. I run a page called Flamingos of Mumbai in Instagram, where I'm trying to create an awareness amongst Mumbaikers for the flamingo migration. Couple of questions I had, which became a long question, in fact. The question was, what can we do more to create awareness about this flamingo migration in India? What we see today with the lockdown is a lot of anecdotal evidence coming from press as though that the migration is due to the lockdown, which I have been regularly refuting. The second thing is, how do we partner the local bodies, the government, as well as BNHS and the public, to make this place a sanctuary, especially the Navi Mumbai NRA complex, lake. What do we do to take steps to create a sanctuary or probably create more awareness with the public of this place?
Yeah, for creating awareness, there are other, like for example, we write in Facebook groups, if you write Birds of Mumbai, all bird watchers are there. They are all aware of the birds. So you have to use different media on which you are not communicating with bird watchers, but with the common public. So you have to use different media. So different media is newspapers. And where you don't have bird watchers, you have general public. So you write in newspapers, give more news in newspapers, coordinate with reporters. That's the best medium. We have seen that. We have done a study and we have found that now, for Flamingo Festival, only 10 to 20% people came because of the Facebook posts. 80% of the people because of newspapers. So if you want to reach the general masses, you need to use the medium which they use. Like might be the radio, the television, and the easiest is the newspapers. So you can write small articles about birds, like interesting tidbits about flamingos. Or do you have flamingos in Mumbai, migration of flamingos. Keep on writing in newspapers, you get more audience, more public. And you can never expect that all people will be aware about good things in nature. Even in Sweden and Switzerland, where the literacy rate is 100%, people are not aware about why the birds are important. They kill birds and they hunt birds. And they have organized groups of hunting birds. Even if the 100% literacy is there. And there is so good communication in those European countries. There are so many hunters and poachers. So you cannot expect 100% people to be literate or aware about birds. And we should not expect that 100% of the people to come to Navi Mumbai and see flamingos. If 1 lakh people come to Navi Mumbai or wetland, entire wetland will be covered with people and there won't be any flamingos. So,
thank you, sir.
But we don't want so many people to come. We want people who love it to come and see it and enjoy it. And we want more people to support the cause. Support the cause means, for example, if somebody wants that the Navi Mumbai pond should be declared as a sanctuary, and when somebody is fighting it in a court or there is a internet petition, we want them out of 1 crore 30 lakh people in Mumbai, we want at least 1 crore 1 lakh to sign. but it's not happening because we are unable to reach to the right people. We are only talking to bird watchers. They are already lovers. So we are trying to convert the country. We have to reach out to the other audience. So that will be...
I'll take one more. Yeah. Thank you, sir. Thank you for that explanation. I'll take one question which came from Harjeet on the chat. He wants to know who's taking care of the BNHS collection during lockdown, the one you have in Hornbill House.
Yeah, there's only one person. There is only one person, and
okay.
What? Because we are, and in monsoon we will not open it. In summer there is no problem to the collection, so it's very safe because the humidity is very very low, so there is no issue. In monsoon we need to take care because the humidity goes down, so they may get decomposed or make more infections or fungus, lot of things. So we need to take more care in monsoon. Now we got permission to have one or two persons there, so. So it's okay. So we are taking care. Whatever happens, there will be a person to take care of the collection. Yeah. The entire office will be shut, but the collection will be taken
care of. Thank you. Yeah. Right. It is very important to conserve that, definitely. So Jairaj has asked one question on chat about sparrows. Is it true that they migrate to northwestern countries or they have migrated to those countries instead of from
India? This is true about house sparrows. Nobody expected that house sparrows migrate, but house sparrows were tagged, that means ringed. Previously BNHS was doing only ringing, so BNHS did ringing of house sparrows in Bharatpur, because in Bharatpur you get a lot of house sparrows inside the sanctuary also, so they were automatically trapped and they were ringed when the water bird survey was going on, and BNHS scientists found that the birds went to Kazakhstan, so that was very surprising. So that means the house sparrows also migrate. So it's though it is a, we have a resident population, but there will be some birds must be migrating around. So that's very good because that will have a big genetic pool. That's very good. Yeah, next.
Okay. One question from Shamkant Potnes on the chat. What is the source of calcium in eggshell? Yeah. Source of calcium in the eggshell. And is there a physical difference between male and female for production of eggs?
No, male doesn't have to produce the eggs. So only female has to produce.
I also read that question. Yeah.
So only female is worried about getting calcium. So birds like hornbills, for example, this is just an example because I studied it. So what hornbills will eat garden lizard. Entire garden lizard is eaten by the female, swallowed. So when she eats the garden lizard, nothing comes out, means the bones, everything is digested. So the garden lizard's bones will serve as a source of calcium to the hornbill. And they also eat the shells, snails. So the shells are eaten and the calcium is taken. So this is how. And I have seen that sparrows and sunbirds, they eat our chuna, the color, the lime color which is given to our buildings. So they eat that color. That is nothing but calcium carbonate, and they get that calcium. So that is also a trick used by birds. So they get calcium through various sources like this.
Question from Vinit.
This is Sham here. Go ahead. The male also eats the same food that the female eats. Where does it go? I mean.
Oh, there is something known as metabolism in the body. There is another word, that is the bones. Inside the bones, the circulation of calcium is always taking place. There is cells are dying and new cells are being created or born. So this process is continuously going on in our body also. So we need calcium every time. Even if you think nothing is happening, that bone is degenerating and new bone is regenerating. Like even blood cells are also... blood cells, skin cells, they are continuously regenerating in every animal's body. So that is happening in birds also. So the males also will take food which has got everything, including calcium, proteins, carbohydrates, everything they need. So they will be eating something which has got calcium. So everything, not only calcium, proteins also. So it's just a metabolism or you can say turnover of body tissues, all tissues. It's a continuous process.
Okay, one question for Vinit about hornbills. What can we do to increase the habitat so that they return to our areas?
We need hornbills. More trees, large trees actually, huge or old trees. So whatever trees we have, we should not cut them so that they later on they have cavities, and inside the cavities they can nest. Also, there is an idea of having artificial nest boxes. If the hornbills are around and there are no good trees with big cavities, because huge trees will take a lot of time to grow. So if there are hornbills around and you put nest boxes with particular size, the hornbills will get a chance to breed. And also we need to save the fruiting trees like figs. The particularly three species of figs, I will say, peepal, burgut. Peepal means Ficus religiosa, burgut means banyan tree or Ficus bengalensis, and Ficus glomerata or cluster fig or umber or gular. These three species of fruits are very, very important and vital for the survival of hornbills and increasing their population in any given area. So we have to ensure that these trees are not cut or more trees are planted.
Okay, thank you, sir. And I have last few questions. I will just wrap up in the next 5 minutes. Okay, so coming back to you once again, Dr. Raju, are you a foodie? What kind of food do you like, or do you cook in free time?
I like everything, veg, non-veg, everything I like. And in Maharashtrian food, I like the puran poli. And in non-veg, I like chicken as well as prawns as well as this seafood. I like, but I take very little nowadays after I had problems with my health. The quantity has gone down, but I enjoy tasting it, of course. Yeah. I think your internet connection is hanging. Yeah.
Coming back. Dr. Raju, you're back on, you're on mute.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I think the Zoom.
I don't know if you heard the last question. It was about your courses and the course participants. Tell us about, you know, some participants you love to talk about, what they have achieved, whether they are funny, weird, whatever, any stories.
Since I took over the Conservation Education Center and the courses, the most enthusiastic people I met are the course participants, because they are the ones whom I meet again and again, and to the level that I know them personally. So I can remember their names. Like I have one, Francis D'Souza. So there are people who are like, they are Adil Ali. And of course we have our Mr. and Mrs. I can't just get their names from Mumbai, the couple. So much enthusiastic and giving a personal touch to everything. So we have got so many partners. Actually, Ashish Babre in another batch, he has become such a tremendous burden. Adil has become a tremendous burden. You are one who are like, you are going beyond that course and you are still there with the birds, doing something. So even the birding community in India is recognizing their efforts. So that is something which makes me proud that I am associated with them. they are becoming so famous. So I always feel proud. Sinap pul jata hai. So there are a lot of people that can feel proud of. Some are doing very good job by writing short notes. Some are doing very excellent photography, Uday Agashi. And so many people actually are. I'm sorry if I cannot remember all names, but there are so many people. Like the Matre is there. He did the butterfly course, then ornithology course. He created a butterfly garden in a place near Palghar.
Wangao,
such a beautiful place. And his brother has. Brother or brother-in-law resigned from a highly paid job and doing nature tourism, butterfly tourism in such a small village, and tremendous food. And we went there, like it was crazy to be there, and the food taste and everything. So there are participants. There is one participant, I can't remember his name. He's a Indian Malayali. He's from Dubai, and he did our butterfly course. He's head of the butterfly garden, huge dome shaped butterfly garden in Dubai. He is in charge. So he is heading that. So there are a lot of people who did courses and joined BNHS. Like we have Viraj Atalay in this right now. He's working in BNHS. So he joined, and there was one girl. Now she married a guy in Bhopal. Her husband is the in charge of the butterfly garden in Bhopal. So there are a lot of people. Sharda ma'am, she is already a great person. She is pursuing this hobby. There are so many people. Jairaj is doing so much for birds on his own. He is spending money. Just look at them and I feel proud. Yes, I am associated with these guys. These are some people I just, as soon as somebody asks, I can remember their name. Rama Bishnu, such a great person, and she still wants to learn. And there is one Arjit Madam. She is, must be 60 plus, I don't know her exact age. Looks like my grandmother. So much enthusiasm to learn. And if you are in the lead bio course, our WhatsApp group or butterfly group, WhatsApp group, she is the most prolific writer of messages. So there are a lot of people like this, and I feel inspired also. Not only proud, I feel inspired also to do more for this.
Thank you very much, sir, for taking so many names. I'm sure they are part of this session and they will see the recording as well. So if you were given a chance to change the mindset of people of India, what would you change and how you would change? What is your dream?
Very difficult. I feel that instead of showing National Geographic, there has to be Indian channels showing good things about Indian wildlife. Then Nat Geo people come to India, make beautiful documentaries about Bandhagad, Tadoba, Karnataka, and show from them. And we see the BBC and Nat Geo and say, oh, Tadoba is so beautiful. But not many Indians are doing. Of course, there are some Indians who are joining Nat Geo and BBC and doing the documentaries on Indian wildlife and showing from Nat Geo website. So we need more people talking about Indian wildlife. If we have more people talking, writing books, writing blogs, writing on social media, writing in newspapers, every medium, those participants which we have, we should write about our Indian wildlife. That will make others who are non-naturalists, non-nature lovers, crazy about what is there in India. And then they will realize, oh, we have got so much in India. Hum log cheeta ke video dekh rahe hain, idhar tere desh mein, we have got so many beautiful things here. So all course participants, all people, if you start writing about what beautiful things we have in our country, what beautiful things we have, wildlife, not only wildlife, the big things like the elephants and tigers, but there are so many species of beetles, there are so many species of dragonflies, damselflies, butterflies. In India, we are still finding new species of frogs in these tumors. So we should write, everybody should write in different medium. And why they are important, why they are useful, right? Why birds are useful in agriculture? Because they feed on insects. Locust, why there are locusts? Because there are no birds or less number of birds. That's why locusts are also there. Might be they are coming from other countries, but in other countries also there are no birds. So where are the birds? Previously, the flocks of rogy star, we finish up those. Swarms of locusts. Now, unfortunately, the rogy starling migration, and had them matched, then the swarm would have disappeared. If there were 50,000 rogy starlings around these swarms, that would have finished these swarms. Unfortunately, the timings did not match, and the swarms were moving in different directions, and rogy starlings in different directions. So somebody has to be there. When I wrote about, gave a presentation about birds in agriculture, somebody asked me, when was the last locust swarm? So this presentation was in April, and in May you saw these swarms coming. So that answered the question very nicely. So everybody needs to write and tell others, means non-birders. If you are telling bird watchers that the birds are important, you know that birds are important. You are already convinced or converted. So we need to go to the other people. I think that's very important.
Thank you, sir. I will wrap up in just 1 minute. To all the participants, thank you very much for watching today. I will share the video on the group. And please, if you like it, share it with others as well, the recording. And Raju sir, thank you so much for being here today. I'm sure all the participants loved it. We've had lots of takeaways, feedback from this session. Really, it was fun speaking to you. All the best for your futures and whatever help or support you need in your work, where we or I can help, please do not hesitate to tell us. And thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And thanks for inviting me. I'm so happy. And whenever the lockdown is over, please come to CEC and to see the wildlife, butterflies, birds, enjoy everything there. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.